African rhythms, passed down to us through ancient spirits. Feel the spirit, a unifying force. Come on, move with the spirit. Stand up, clap your hands. Move with the rhythms, get down.
From WSNC, a broadcasting service of Winston-Salem State University, welcome to Africa World Now Project. I'm your host, James Pope. Today we will explore the work of Ngũgĩ wa Thiong'o. Ngũgĩ wa Thiong'o is one of the African world's most prolific writers, thinkers, cultural workers, playwrights, and activists. Growing up in colonial Kenya, his dream of a free Africa has continuously shaped his work. In 1977, he began a new form of theater with Ngaahika Ndeenda, which sought to liberate the theatrical process from what he considered the general bourgeois education system. Despite its success, the authoritarian Kenyan regime shut it down and he was subsequently imprisoned for more than a year. He was eventually released and left for the U.S., where he still resides. Early on, Ngũgĩ understood the interdependent relationship between the politics of memory, language, and resistance, a process that prompted him to write in this language, Kikuyu. Among his extensive works are novels, plays, short stories, essays, such as, but not limited to, Writers in Politics, Decolonizing the Mind, Moving the Center, Penpoints, Gunpoints, and Dreams, Weep Not, Child, Petals of Blood, Wizard of the Crow, Dreams in the Time of War, and In the House of the Interpreter, a Memoir. Currently distinguished professor of English and Comparative Literature at the University of California, Irvine, Ngũgĩ wa Thiong'o has also taught at Yale and New York universities. He is recipient of 10 honorary doctoral degrees and is founder and editor of a Kikuyu language journal. Ngũgĩ wa Thiong'o is a frequent Nobel nominee. Before we dive into a deep exploration of Ngugi's work, we will first listen to Ngũgĩ himself in a talk titled Remembering Africa, Retrieval and Exchange of African Memory. Enjoy.
Yesterday, for those who are not here, I talked basically about the planting of European memory on Africa and the consequent, sort of fragmentation, or rather the planting of memory in Africa as part of the fragmentation, of the continent, what I call dismemberment. The most important, of course, being the first dismemberment, around slavery, when Africans, millions were brought by force into America and the Caribbean, the Pacific, and so on, followed by other types of dismemberment within a continent, Berlin Conference being one of them. But I also talked about, dismemberment from economy, from power, and in a way, most important also, disconnection from memory, so that the European memory of plays and so on planted on the land, on our bodies, on our mind, becomes more or less the starting point of our memories. And also I tried to say yesterday, and which is the running theme in these three lectures, is the need for wholeness. And I'm trying to argue that, in fact, so many movements in Africa are movements in quest of that wholeness. So today I'm going to talk a little bit about remembering practices and visions. That really basically is the title of this lecture. It's slightly different from what you have on the leaflet. Remembering practices and visions. And remember, I'm using the word remembering in the two senses of remember, something which has been dismembered, remember, and also remember in a sense of memory and so on, those two senses, The other senses which emerged yesterday during the discussions and so on, and they are evoked by the word, remembering or remembering Africa. So I'm going to talk a little about remembering visions and practices. Stories of dismemberment and remembering can be found in African myths, the oldest and best known being the Egyptian story of Osiris, Isis, and Horus, the original trinity of father, mother, and their only begotten son. It is a story that fascinates African writers. Aiko Yama of Ghana has recently published a novel of series writing. And a Kenyan, Kamoju Ashira, imprisoned by the post-colonial Kenya government for 2 years in a lonely camp in 1982, in a lonely camp where once Mau Mau resistance fighters were tortured by the British in pre-independent days, writes an epic in Gikuyu called Thagana Therera, addressed to Thagana, the main river in Kenya, and finds himself evoking the inspirational memory of the Egyptian Trinity in a Kenyan anti-colonial resistance. In the valley, I'm just quoting him, in the valley of your mother-in-law, the mighty Kiira, now nicknamed Nile, daughter of Namlolwe, she too, like you, rolls and flows along forever, causing toward the kingdom of Isis and Horus, the falcon god, an old kingdom bequeathed them by their father Osiris, he of the crown crested with twin plumes of white ostrich feather. Kiira, Nile, who, like you, has suffered much triumph and pain, she, understanding your cry of help, quickly answered you, took to heart the cause of your beloved folk, manacled and detained. She thus inspired the whole world to cry shame to the British jailers of your fighters. Thanks to her, Hola, the death camp, was closed. But it will be reopened by the post-colonial government, of course. Kamoju Ashira is, of course, drawing parallels between the colonial and neocolonial tortures, and he hopes that the unity brought about by the river's cycle of life will also cry shame to the neocolonial jailers. Why does the Egyptian myth hold such fascination with writers in post-colonial Africa? Why, we might ask ourselves, does a political prisoner in solitary confinement in a semi-desert area in 1982 turn to the myth, millions of years old, for inspiration in facing the present in Africa? According to Plutarch, Isis is killed by his brother Seth, who throws the coffin into River Nile. Isis recovers the box and hides it. Seth, who stumbles upon the recovered box, is angry, and he cuts up Osiris' body into 14 pieces he scatters all over Egypt. The indefatigable Isis, in an act of love and devotion, travels all over Egypt, recovers the fragments, erecting a tomb to Osiris wherever she finds a piece. With the help of the deity Thoth, she remembers the fragments and restores Isis to life. Out of the fragments, an observance of proper mourning rites comes wholeness in both the sense of a body remembered, but also a body remembered with its spirit. The fascination lies in a quest for wholeness, a quest which underlies African struggles since the Atlantic slave trade. Though Ethiopianism and the like preceded them, Gavism and Pan-Africanism are the grandest secular visions for reconnecting the dismembered. Gavism, with its Caribbean roots, unfolded on the terrain of America, but its vision, embodied in the title of Garvey's organization, the Universal Negro Improvement Association, had the continent and its diaspora in view, with the phrase, Africa for the Africans, those at home and those abroad, becoming the chorus of Garvey's speeches and plans. The name actually was meant to embrace, and I quote him, to embrace the purpose of all black humanity, to be free and an equal member of the community of nations and peoples. For behind the rhetoric of blackness was also a universalist humanist vision of using the Universal Negro Improvement Association to inspire African peoples, and I quote him, to inspire them with pride in self and with the determination of going ahead in the creation of those ideals that will lift them to the unprejudiced company of races and nations. There's no desire for hate or malice, but every wish to see all mankind linked into a common fraternity of progress and achievement that will wipe away the odor of prejudice and elevate the human race to the height of real godly love and satisfaction. End of the quote. Remembering the twin halves, the core themes of Pan-Africanism in general, was central to his vision of seeing black people as active players in the world. Du Bois' Pan-Africanism, with its Afro-Caribbean, African-American, and continental African roots, saw the connection of the educated stratum to the masses as an absolute must in the fight to free African subjectivity. This best contained in the resolution of the 5th Pan-African Congress held in Manchester, England in 1945. The Congress, which brought together African, Caribbean, and African-American intellectuals and political activists, came up with, among other resolutions, the now famous Declaration to Colonial Peoples of the World, in which they put African workers at the front line of the struggle against imperialism. The declaration called upon the intellectual and professional classes of the colonies to awaken to their responsibilities and join the workers to fight for the right to form trade unions and cooperatives, to assemble freely, hold demonstrations and strikes, and for the freedom to print and read literature necessary for the education of the masses. Today they continue. Today there's only one road in the
organization. You are tuned in to Africa World Now Project on WSNC 90.5, a broadcasting service of Winston-Salem State University. I am James Pope. You were just listening to a segment of a talk delivered by Ngũgĩ titled Remembering Africa, Retrieval and Exchange of African Memory. We will now transition into a discussion I had with Dr. Josh Myers, where we explored what he termed the enduring rhythm of Ngũgĩ Thiong'o, a conversation on decolonization as a deep process of remembering, resistance, and restoration. Dr. Josh Myers teaches Africana Studies in the Department of Afro-American Studies at Howard University and is a board member of the Association for the Study of Classical African Civilizations and Positive Black Folks in Action. Enjoy. I'm here today with Dr. Josh Myers, and we want to talk about decolonization, Pan-Africanism, and a piece that he wrote called The Enduring Rhythm of Ngũgĩ Thiong'o. Josh, thank you for being here today.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me.
You write in this piece that was published back in March 30th, 2016 of this year. You start this piece out, and the title again is The Enduring Rhythm of Ngũgĩ Thiong'o. You start this piece out, and I'm going to read it in length so we can kind of contextualize the conversation. You started out, the African future. Many have mused about its meanings. Many have predicted its possibilities. Few have considered its philosophical basis. Even fewer have considered its spiritual foundation. What will be the moral compass that guides the African future? Who will determine what is good for Africa, for Africans, for those willing to answer these questions in ways that privilege the humanity and cultural authority of African peoples, for those unwilling to subject the African future to the whims of those who would answer these questions from a political culture beholden to the traditional sources of African doom? Above all, capital. And for those orientation is guided by what Anderson Thompson once called the African principle. You go on to say that we cannot begin to answer these questions without a deep engagement with the intellectual work of Kenyan writer Ngũgĩ wa Thiong'o. Why?
Thank you. The premise of much of Ngũgĩ's work has been this consistent and profound idea that African peoples must inject a cultural sensibility, a cultural authority via the elevation and the application of African languages to questions of how to be in the world, how to exist in the world, what it means to be human. If you look at his work going back to the late 1960s and early 1970s, there's this consistent idea. That's why I call this article The Enduring Rhythm, because throughout the latter half of the 20th century, regardless of what the political and the cultural kind of changes have been, Ngũgĩ has been consistent about this idea that all people have a culture, all people have a language. Somehow, African people have assumed that the best avenue towards freeing themselves has been utilizing the cultural authority in the language, particularly English, and the traditions that come out of those languages as somehow the best means by which to free themselves. For Ngũgĩ, the idea has been the exact opposite. That is to say, African people's languages must be not only the means of communication, but the carrier of a culture, and out of that culture, questions of freedom based on how African peoples have resisted throughout the past 500 years must become the norm in how we think about and live our resistance today.
So the connection is deep here. You're talking about the enduring rhythm, and also you're talking about language. And language naturally has a rhythm, and is based upon. And would you say that rhythm and the colonization, pre-colonized Africa, colonized Africa, and the so-called post-colonial Africa, how do we understand or kind of look at that particular interrelationship with the enduring rhythm of what Ngũgĩ is trying to say, or what Ngũgĩ is specific, not I wouldn't say trying to say, what who he is saying, and how do we juxtapose that within the context of freedom and liberation for Africa today?
Well, what he talks about in Secure the Base, what he talks about in Something Torn and New, what he talks about in Decolonizing the Mind, all of his, you know, critical works that have been coming out over the past 45 years, is that part of colonization was the stripping away of the language, what he calls the dismembering process of African peoples included the dismembering of their language. And because the language carries so much, it carries philosophy, it carries, you know, culture, it carries ethics, it carries spirituality, it carries so much, it was easier to subjugate African peoples once that dismembering process actually occurs. In fact, what he talks about consistently is how religion was used to do that. In fact, one of the ironies of this is that the reason that these African languages, many of them like Kikuyu, like Yoruba, like the tree languages of Ghana, many of them are only reduced to writing to facilitate the imposition of Christianity. In other words, the reason that we have grammars of Yoruba or grammars of Kikuyu was because these missionaries needed that language to, in fact, impose Christianity, to kind of give translations of the Christian text so that African peoples could read literally their colonization in their own language. If you think about how deep that was, somehow we think that we can just use English, whereas even our colonizers knew that even to subjugate us, they had to use our languages.
Which is a very important point, because again, we're on the theme of the enduring rhythm, and that enduring rhythm has a very, very important context within the context of Ngũgĩ's work. And you mentioned decolonizing the mind. How does this conceptual and practical application of decolonization, how would this look according to Ngũgĩ? But then we'll kind of move this conversation into a diasporic context. But how would decolonization look? How can we keep it from becoming a buzzword appropriated by Black elites and others?
The thing about Black elites is they're not willing to do the kind of work that Ngũgĩ is doing, because it's going to take long and deep work. In fact, the elites are only there to kind of appropriate or to kind of find their own niche into the ways that we use intellectual trends and intellectual movements. But what Ngũgĩ is proposing is actually the kind of long, deep cultural work that has to occur. And in many ways, the elite are not only not prepared to do that kind of work, but many of them are very clearly unwilling to engage in that kind of process. So what he proposes in a book that came out in 2009, book of speeches and essays, Something Torn and New, is that we need to participate in this act of translation and recovery. What is very clear is that many of the languages that were supposedly destroyed by colonization are actually still spoken. And what are one of our duties as intellectuals, meaning people who are trained in the Western Academy but who are now becoming renegades, what Cedric Robinson calls the renegade Black intelligentsia, we have to commit what Cabral called class suicide, and in fact listen and engage and be in community with what Ngũgĩ calls the griot, the collective griot, and that is the peasantry, what he called the peasantry, meaning the people who still have access to these ideas, to these languages. Very interesting, about three or four years ago, Wole Soyinka spoke at the Free Library of Philadelphia, and one of the questions that was asked is, you know, how do we get, you know, access to this deep African spirituality that you're talking about in your book of Africa? How do we get, you know, acclimated again? How do we return home again? And Soyinka said something I thought was very poignant, particularly to people who like to visit the continent. He says, don't go to the cities. In fact, avoid the cities. Go to the countryside, because that's where people are still doing this work. And so Ngũgĩ is saying that in that context, in those locations, we have to be able to not only translate and recover these languages, but we have to engage in a process of what he called in his latest book of essays, the kind of globalectic process. Of course, this is a riff on the idea of the dialectic. But this idea of globalectics, meaning using African languages or using who you are in the world to speak to not only where you are, but to where everyone else is. That is to say that African languages, African culture, African spirituality can actually read the world. It's not simply a isolated thing. But it starts from this idea of the collective griot, being in communion with people who still have access to these languages, but also translating the ideas that come from the world into the languages that our people speak and that our people still use.
So let me pull in this thread for a second. Suppose now let's put this out in a grander scheme of things. And there are a number of people specifically here in the diaspora here in the United States who would say that, you know, I don't know African. First of all, I'm not even African. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure Ngũgĩ is addressing these particular concepts of how do you kind of, and then you mentioned Cabral, returning to the source. You're talking about class suicide. You're raising some very, very important points here. But before we really kind of get into that, let's look at it within the context of how can it be incorporated? How can what Ngũgĩ is saying, how can that be incorporated into the intellectual fabric of those who teach the intellectual pedagogy, but also the practical daily lives of African peoples, and what role would the community play in this?
It's a great question. Ngũgĩ has some very interesting things to say about the diaspora in a lot of his works. Among the most interesting is the concept of linguicide, and I think that's what you're speaking to in the early part of your question, the idea that the African in the diaspora somehow lost the African tongue. And in a very interesting point that he makes, and this is also in his book, Something Torn and New, he says that in the face of linguicide, what African people in the diaspora did was they hid the African language systems, the grammatical systems, in the colonial languages, such that we have a robust tradition of Haitian Creole. We have a robust tradition of the Patois and a robust tradition of Ebonics that still embeds the spiritual core, the philosophical core of how Africans answer the questions of what it means to be human. So the intellectual is very clear. Where is our grammar for Ebonics? Where is our, you know, philosophical, you know, foundation that we could apply to this idea of Ebonics and how we could use that as a philosophy of the masses? Almost something that has never been considered except for a select few of scholars, people like Lorenzo Dow Turner and others, about the masses. They're not intellectually isolates. They have philosophies. They have ways of knowing that are embedded in how they read and communicate to the world. And if the intellectual doesn't have access to that, who are we speaking to? Who are we speaking for? It becomes an academic practice.
And so this brings us to a very, very important question, because we talk about practice, we talk about theory and practice. How important is it to bring this conversation out from the academy? What are the dangers of not incorporating the masses? Because we mentioned the masses, and here I'm thinking about a notion that you mentioned specific earlier when we started this conversation, the notion of Amilcar Cabral's class suicide. And again, how important is it to bring this conversation out of the academy? If we're talking about decolonization, we're talking about it not just at an intellectual pedagogy or institutional level, but at a daily life, the daily lives of people who are still witnessing marginalization on the daily lives, because we're talking about decolonization. And that process is inherently against those who attempt to recolonize or keep colonized. How important is it to bring this conversation out from the academy?
Absolutely. The language of, and I think we're going to talk about this in a few minutes, but the language of colonization, of the colony, has to be applied to all colonies. In fact, America, United States of America, a settler colony, Canada, a settler colony. Many of the Western, the countries of the Western Hemisphere started off as colonies. So why don't we ever use the language of post-colonialism when we talk about America? America, too, is a post-colony. But a very different post-colony than we see in other parts of the world. But the idea then, for me, is to, for Black studies at least, there is an inherent relationship to the people outside of the academy. Ethan here talks about the bringing the town to the gown and gown to the town, but part of that idea is to decolonize the university, because the university in its formation, in its origin, is in some ways antithetical to this kind of mass, this idea of mass education or having the masses being involved in the process. So what Ronaldo Walcott, the scholar up at University of Toronto, has been recently pushing is this idea that we need to think more about not simply decolonizing the university, we need to decolonize societies. In a university, if it's going to be relevant at all to this process, has to be at the forefront of that, particularly HBCUs and other institutions where we have a collective, what Fred Moten and Stefano Harding call undercommons, a kind of undercommons insurgency project that is happening. Whatever we get from the university, whatever we steal from the university, that's the word they use, needs to be used for the liberation of African peoples and all other oppressed peoples in the world.
So history is cyclical. We tend to think that it's a linear process, that you move from one point cleanly to another point. Mm-hmm. And so in actuality, this question of decolonization that is being raised by youth in Africa, in South Africa, Burkina Faso, in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, in Canada, in Jamaica, all around the world, Brazil, there are things going on. We seem to be at a place when you mentioned Black studies, and we, you know, go over briefly that specific origins of Black studies as being an insurgent intellectual project that was insurgent into the the colonial apparatus of the university, mm-hmm. Because again, the university and the educational institutions of the colonial state is to reinforce the colonial mindset and the colonial practices and the colonial culture of those that it educates. So we would you say that we're at that point again? That point of the insurgency of the unrest that surrounded Black studies to become evolved and to become into the academy. Would you say that we're kind of going back to that particular point?
Brother, I would hope so. And yes, I think we're at the cusp of such a moment. But here's what I want to challenge us, particularly the young people who are raising their voices, who are resisting, and that's the importance of study. What made Ngugi's project so critical was that it came out of a deep study, a process of study. There were study circles. There was, there were writing circles. There were people who were actually working out these ideas together. You know, yes, it's important to do the protests, to be in the streets. Yes, it's critical that we do some of the kind of performance of these kind of, I don't want to say performance theater, but it does come out of that. Absolutely.
Yeah.
But when you look at what Ngugi and his colleagues were doing with the abolition of the English department, first of all, why is there an English department in an African university that excludes African writers? But that kind, you can't come to that kind of knowledge, without deeply interrogating the structures of colonialism or deeply interrogating the structures of what Ngugi would call imperialism. But what is the function of an English department? And how do you get rid of it? And I think we see that happening at least on the continent. It's happening less so, unfortunately, in the States. I think decolonization, or the idea of decolonization and insurgency, has been reduced to a plea for diversity. And Robin Kelly writes about this in the Boston Review article, Black Study. I think it's Black Study, Black Struggle is the title of that article. But, yes, study has to be at the center of it. Intellectual work and debate and the working out of these concepts has to be at the center of anything that we do bearing the name of decolonization, because ultimately, as Roderick Ferguson argues in his book, The Reorder of Things, these institutions can incorporate all of that resistance if we don't understand what we're actually fighting for.
And that seems to be happening right now, specifically when we look at the Black Lives Matter, the Black Lives Matter movement.
Yes.
There seems to be an appropriation, but again, that is something that should be understood as step one with a colonial power trying to appropriate or co-opt the resistance that is bubbling up from below. And I wanted to kind of touch on, we've been touching on a number of particular issues here. I want to pull in this thread of something about what is the role for HBCUs in this decolonization conversation, a discourse that is going on around the African world. Is there a role for HBCUs? Because there seem to be solid, and should there be an expectation for HBCUs to add their voice? And I'm saying this particularly given a lot of the elite sensibilities at a lot of our HBCUs.
Absolutely. The irony of this is that in a settler colony that has taken stolen labor from another continent and then used that labor to build the economic foundation of that colony, the idea that you can then educate that labor to be part of that system was never actually supposed to be an idea. It wasn't supposed to be a thing. HBCUs are in many ways paradoxical to what I would say what the real function of the United States of America is. And in many ways, their role for empire is to cultivate an elite to do just that, to in fact control the kind of ideas that come out of America's internal enemy, the African. And so to decolonize the HBCU is in many ways is to let loose the kind of Black radical tradition on American society, and you're always going to have people of African descent who are against that. But at the same time, as Ngugi's work shows us, is that you can't really kill the idea of resistance. It's always going to be there. So can we expect these institutions that were never designed to do this kind of work, to do that kind of work. A useful kind of heuristic that my colleague Harold McDougall over at Howard Law School has generated to really speak to this is that we have to look at these institutions as both communal and as administrative or institutional. So communal, Howard, is very clear that there's a duty here to kind of push the idea of decolonization. But we have to understand that it's very difficult to really really claim this as the mantle for institutional or administrative, Howard. Absent a true force, absent a robust resistance force that has to come from the base of our society, HBCUs will continue to, in many ways, play this kind of role of the Mandarin or the comprador to American empire, but that's something that we can accept.
So this brings us to the question, because you're raising it, we're actually touching on a historical point between the evolution or the our making HBCUs or taking them into this conversation of the Black University.
Absolutely.
Right. So speak a little bit on what you're talking about within the context of the decolonization process that HBCUs have to really take back on this conversation of what it means to create a Black University.
Well, yes. First, there has to be a historical. We need to know the history, and that's the first step. Most people think of the HBCUs as evolving to a point where we can generate that elite in places that will then force into existence the kind of people like Debbie Allen or Bill Cosby, people who are very clear that they're Black. And they want to do Black content in their entertainment, in their art, in their intellectual work, but also not about this question of creating a Black society or creating a Pan-African movement around Blackness as a global identity. They're not clear about that. Or if they are clear, they're clearly against it. So as we degenerate more and more of these elites, the history that we see that produced the Black University concept is obscured. People don't know that history. So the first thing is we need to know that history. And secondly, I think we need to deal with the context. So the 1960s, very different from, you know, this decade. Part of what was possible in the 1960s because of the kind of liberal order that persisted where, you know, America was experiencing this growth economy, and some of that money was being used in LBJ's Great Society, and all of a sudden, you know, HBCUs are getting this funding, and then you get to the 1960s and the 1970s, that funding is used in insurgent ways to bring in scholars who had never been brought in 30 years earlier, who are thinking about liberation in a very particular way. But now we live in the era of the neoliberal university, and that is going to change and alter how we're even able to generate students, how we even are able to bring in faculty. And that has to be acknowledged as well. But the Black University concept was very simple and profound. It stated that if we're going to be Black, if we're going to have Black students, if we're going to be in this space where we all come out of the same racial experiences, we all share the same cultural identities, then why doesn't the curriculum, why doesn't the energy, the orientation, why doesn't it represent Blackness in that way? Du Bois said it beautifully in 1933 in an essay called The Field and Function of the Negro University, where he talks about the French university. You can expect it to have French language. You can expect it to have French literature. You can expect it to be grounded in French history. The Spanish university. You can expect it to have to utilize Spanish language, the Spanish language, and to be premised on Spanish literature and Spanish history. But somehow the Negro university is grounded in the American tradition. Are we just American, or are we bigger than that identity? And I think if we're going to have this notion of a black university, we have to do, as Du Bois says, we have to begin with black history and to get to universal history. Begin with black sociology to get to universal sociology. Begin with black philosophy to get to universal philosophy. I think that has to be at the core. But as I said earlier, that impulse is not going to come from the people who run these universities. It has to come from people who are, in many ways, occupy those universities on a communal level. And that has to be the reality.
Because out of the tradition, out of the historical genealogy, the decolonization process here in the United States with African peoples in the diaspora in Africa, that communication becomes very, very important. The merging of community, the merging of institutions. Mm-hmm. Let's touch on, let's situate this conversation in the historical genealogy of decolonization in the United States. And we want to look at this in relation to the African world, specifically the Haitian Revolution, Maroon communities, because what I'm hearing you say in your conversation, in this conversation that we're having, and I'm pulling on this thread, and I'm hearing Maroon spaces, creating Maroon spaces. And so when we think about it in the historical genealogy of decolonization and of African peoples dealing with Western institutions, what is the historical genealogy of that? Looking at Ethiopian resistance to Italy, Algeria, Ghana, Angola, Cuba, decolonization seems to be understood as something not related to the socio-political experience of Afro-descendants here in the United States. The whole concept of decolonization or colonization, we talked about it, you know, framing the conversation or framing our intellectual and our practical discourses and actions in understanding a colonial experience.
Let's talk about the historical
genealogy of decolonization in relation to the Haitian Revolution, in relation to creating Maroon spaces, because that's essentially what we're talking about.
Absolutely. And Maroonage is at the center of African resistance. Robin Kelly called it the first principle of African resistance. It's the first thing that we did to resist. And it is necessarily decolonial, because if these formations that we found ourselves in were colonies, anything we did to resist was decolonization. So in many ways, Maroonage is the African's unique kind of approach to the question of decolonization. Remove yourself, ensure that once you remove yourself, you can take care of yourself, but also generate a new way of being, an alternative way of existing in that separate physical location, in that separateness. There's something different happening. We're not creating new plantations. You know, my colleague and mentor, you know, Greg Carr, kind of tongue-in-cheek, but in many ways accurately describes the energies at universities. He doesn't call them, you know, HWCUs or PWIs and HBCUs. He says, no, we're HMCU, the historically maroon college and university. And, you know, Harvard, Yale, they're historically plantation colleges and universities. That reorients us to understanding the function, the field and function, as Du Bois would say, of these universities. What does a plantation do? Produce, reduce labor to their productive value, and then use the products of that labor to, in many ways, to enrich the owners and the elite. And what do Maroon communities do? They create new spaces that alter how we think about relationships to each other. And I think in many ways, making HBCUs Maroon spaces is very, very much an aspirational ideal. But if that's not the aspiration, ultimately, what are you reproducing? Plantation ideologies. And that's something that, again, has to be resisted, because ultimately, is not going to free us. The plantation will not free us. One of the things that Ngũgĩ says in his work, another consistent rhythm, is firstly that imperialism and liberation cannot coexist. And human liberation, let's just eradicate the idea that somehow we can negotiate with this system. But the second thing that he says is there's no mistake that the prison, that the plantation, and that the colony all coexisted at the same time. And in many ways, what made that possible is, and something that I hope we can get into next, is the idea of the nation state.
let's get into it. So when we're talking about the nation state, we're talking about it as something that is applied and developed within the context of a certain historical moment, using certain cultural accessibilities to develop the nation state. So how do we understand that within the context of creating these spaces that are maroon spaces, decolonizing education curriculum, and also our lived behaviors, our lived processes, and the way that we think about ourselves, and the way that we think about others, and the way that we think about ourselves and others in relation to the universe, to nature, the spiritual traditions? How does that all interact? How does that all have a the nation state have an impact on what we're talking about?
In his book of essays, the lectures that he did, I believe they're at Oxford, and Ngũgĩ talks about, the book's called Penpoints, Gunpoints, and Dreams. And Ngũgĩ talks about the inherent nature of the nation state or the state as conservative. States only exist to conserve a certain order. And that political order, of course, in many ways is the result of our enslavement and colonization. So the state itself comes into being, the form itself comes into being as a mechanism by which to conserve the relationships that originated with our enslavement and the post emancipation societies that you know crystallize into nation states, the neo colonies that come after the former colonization. These states are in many ways just as much the oppressive systems that we were fighting against. In many ways, the nation state is a prison, as I say in the article. It's an open-air prison to our possibilities of actually self-determining what kind of world we want to actually live in. What's the other part of that question?
We wanted to look at the interrelation of also impacting on these spaces of creating decolonization. The conversation or the discourse is decolonization.
Right,
trying to see in the grand scheme of the discourse, what is the role of the diaspora, what is the role of HBCUs, what is the role of that in these particular conversations?
Yes, and it's hard for us, you know, to imagine life beyond the nation state. The nation state is often assumed as the teleological kind of result of what it means to struggle for freedom. In fact, there's a very interesting book by, I think his first name is Gary Wilder, called Freedom Time. And he goes through the writings of Leopold Senghor and the writings of Aimé Césaire, and he talks about their anti-colonial resistance and their imaginations of a society that does not mirror the idea of the nation state. Now, we can quibble with whether or not Senghor was naive in the idea of articulating whether or not a federation with France was better than an autonomous nation state. But I think there's something in this notion that we did not necessarily have to create nation states after decolonization, or nation states on the model, if you will, of Western nation states. And that's something that we have to think about. And I think the best way to think about it is to study post-emancipation Haiti. Because in Haiti, there were many options on the table about what kind of society could they have created after, of course, they beat the French. A number of books on this topic about the Haitian Constitution, recent books. Julia Gaffield has written a recent book on the Haitian Constitution of 1805, I think. 1805. Yeah. It has to be considered, because ultimately, if we simply reproduce the idea of the nation state, we're reproducing the idea that status quo has to be conserved in some way, in some form. And in fact, Ngũgĩ argues and pinpoints that the nation state, or the idea of the state, is often about stability, whereas art, literature, is about movement. Do you want to stay in one space, or do you want to move and think about ourselves as beyond this kind of stricture or this kind of containment of being in this idea of the state? And I think that's something that has to be considered.
And the platform to considering this becomes very important. And this leads me to a very, very important question that I'm intellectually and also practically dealing with in my own work, in one particular component of looking at freedom and how it conceptualizations from the ground up. So this brings me to a specific question that we really want to deal with in this conversation. How does Pan-Africanism as a movement and theoretical framework and decolonization relate? Does Pan-Africanism need to be re-examined? Because we seem to have a notion that Pan-Africanism as an idea or and our movement has been set as if it was and is not an evolutionary process of radical praxis. It seems to think, you know, when we think about and teach about Pan-Africanism, we tend to point to specific individuals. But when we look at the practice, even in the 21st century, there is definitely a split in the ideological and also in the practical sense that Pan-Africanism has kind of, you have continental Pan-Africanism and then you have nationalist Pan-Africanism. Like, do we really need to re-examine and see exactly what was going on in those early conversations? Because I, for one, have never seen W.E.B. Du Bois, although individuals and most people kind of give him to be the archetype or the originator, the father of Pan-Africanism. I never saw him in his work say that I am that.
Absolutely.
And I think that it's very, very important for us to really look at it, because if we're talking about diaspora connections with the continental Africa, this becomes important, the platform, because we've touched on the nation state. We talked about the decolonization process. How does, you know, do we need to decolonize Pan-Africanism?
In many ways, yes, brother. There's so much to think about here. There's so many people that struggled under the banner of Pan-Africanism. You mentioned Du Bois, you go back to 1900. You know, Du Bois wasn't alone. He wasn't the only, you know, Negro American in London in 1900. There was Anna Julia Cooper, who's often erased from the Pan-African struggle. You know, there was Alexander Walters. There were so many others who helped him come up with, you know, that declaration, you know, to the nations of the world, where they collectively make the claim that the problem of the 20th century is the problem of the color line. The context of that quote even being a Pan-African meeting, as opposed to simply his book, The Souls of Black Folk. So many people quote that not knowing that you're talking about something that come out of Pan-African struggle. So, yes, there's so much here. Ron Walters, of course, him teasing out the relationships between, you know, Africans who control states and Africans who don't control states, and Africans who are in African origin states and Africans who are in African diasporic states that are controlled by Africans. There's so much here. With the recent news that Haiti was going to join the African Union, and then quickly the African Union says, no, only African states can join the African Union. It's like, is Haiti not the quintessential African state?
And, you know, we talked about that a little bit a few weeks ago.
You know, and another point, I think I lost my point. Cedric Robinson, and I think we're going to talk about him in a few. He wrote an important article, I think. I cite this article often, in 1996, In Search of a Pan-African Commonwealth, where he teases out, he comes up with a new way to think of Pan-Africanism in this piece. We often think about Pan-Africanism as political Pan-Africanism, meaning state relationships. State relationships, and then, of course, diasporic relationships. But what Robinson is doing in that article is looking at human relationships. How do humans relate to each other in a world, of course, that uses the state to kind of facilitate human relationships? But what kind of structures can we create that allow for human-to-human interaction to be privileged over the identities as belonging to a state and the political interests that states have? And I think that's an article that rethinks, in a way that I think you want to rethink, this notion of Pan-Africanism as merely this kind of state-to-state idea.
Yeah, because we really need to start to interrogate the frames, the philosophical the foundation of knowledge development, specifically in the African world. Making sure that we are direct and clear and intentional in our analysis and understanding the continuities in the history, politics, culture, and arts, languages. And this is the reason why we're situating this conversation on Ngũgĩ, because we tend to not really understand the importance of language, of linguistics, in fashioning our consciousness, mm-hmm. Let alone developing a critical consciousness. Mm-hmm. And so that's the reason why this idea of Pan-Africanism and its relationship decolonization becomes important.
important. And we really, I mean, again, I'm an advocate of we got to decolonize the concept of Pan-Africanism.
Absolutely. And right? We can think about Pan-Africanism as originating on the plantations. If we are serious about our study, we understand that, you know, many of the Africans who found themselves together on these plantations came from different parts of the continent. There was no homogenous, or some people like to say that a composite African, or some people say that we became composite Africans. But in that process of, even if you take that idea of becoming a composite African, that was a Pan-African process. Meaning, we got to figure out how to survive
together. You know, that becomes very, very important. And then also, let's push on that idea that when we look at Pan-Africanism being developed, but that process had to already have been embryonic in the cultural fabric of Africans being snatched from the continent.
Absolutely.
Right. So touch on that idea a little bit of the Pan-African idea before the enslavement period.
Well, African people did not simply they weren't isolated. Many of them weren't isolated. Of course, you have some areas of the continent where you have Africans living in more remote and rural areas. But particularly if you think about Senegambia, the area that was in many ways first in terms of the European development of the transatlantic slave trade, they were a cosmopolitan society. And we see this kind of elevated in this new version of Roots. Kunta Kinte talking about he wants to leave home and go to study in one of the great universities African people have ever created, and probably is a probably reductionist even call it a university if you think about what a university is. But they moved around, they knew each other, they traveled. You know, some of the great travel narratives come from African scholars, Ibn Battuta and others. So the assumption that they would not have had the diplomatic skills or the ability to speak and to communicate with other Africans who may not have shared their so-called ethnic background is fallacious. And those skills were used in many ways to help us survive, not only resisting enslavement on the continent itself, but also resisting enslavement on the ships, resisting enslavement on the plantations. Beautiful work of Michael Gomez, Exchanging Our Country Marks, helps us tease through what that looked like, at least in the United States or North American context in the South.
So I wanted to end our conversation on summarizing the point here is that we talked about decolonization. But let's end on this idea of Renaissance okay. and Ngũgĩ's work.
Yes.
Let's talk about that.
Well, Renaissance being the idea of going back, or this notion of rebirth, the rebirth of African languages in a new political and social context. The Egyptians would likely call this concept wehime mesu, the repetition of the birth. Meaning when you ascend to a different station in life, or when you are moving to a different historical moment, to affirm who you are, your identity, to affirm what you must do, your duty, you have to repeat this process of birth. That is, our traditions have to be at the center of anything that we do going forward. And I think that's really what Ngũgĩ is speaking about when he talks about this notion of Renaissance. And of course, in his notion of Renaissance, he talks about this in Something Torn and New, as well as in Secure the Base. Language has to be the vehicle for that rebirth, for that Renaissance. Otherwise, what are we doing?
Again, that was Dr. Josh Myers, who teaches Africana Studies at Howard University. Thank you for joining us today.
I appreciate you having me.
That's it for Africa World Now Project for this week. I would like to thank you for joining us today and look forward to spending time with you next week. We could be reached through all your regular social media platforms. Email africaworldnowproject@gmail.com or follow us on Twitter at AFWRLDNWPRJ. I'm your host and producer, James Pope. The Africa World Now Project Collective consists of international media journalist, executive producer, and human rights activist Moise Matali, and Africa World Now Project media correspondent Fuma Ngunda. It is heard every Wednesday at 7 p.m. on WSNC, a broadcasting service of
Winston-Salem State University. Until next week, be peaceful, be safe, and above all, be intelligent.
By the early 1500s,